necessary for the small open economy that its saving, desired saving must be equal to investment. Open economy for which the equilibrium condition is not similar to the closed economy, where we were saying that desired savings might be larger than desired investment in the open economy, even then the small open economy can be in equilibrium. And we also say that there's a condition where we said that small open economy can also be in equilibrium even when investment is larger than saving, given whatever the world expected rate of interest is. So we represented these conditions using a diagram. So I'm going to show you some slides pertaining to the last topic. So let's look at can you see the screen? Yes, Mohammad Ali, a small open economy is definitely too small to affect the world real interest rate. Now, what does this mean? It means that the lending and borrowing and import exports of a small open economy like Pakistan are not that much large that it influences the world real interest rate. But if we take into consideration the large open economy like US, China, South Korea, Australia, Japan, then they are the largest, like China is one of the largest exporter to the world. So any change in Chinese export will affect the world trading pattern as well as the world real interest rate. But when it comes to small open economy, it's different. For the small open economy, the world real interest rate has to be assumed fixed for understanding its international lending and borrowing and its international trade. So let's look at the equilibrium of the small open economy first, and then we'll move to the equilibrium of large open economy, where we left the discussion. So this is the first case where we are trying to represent the case of a small open economy. So you know the necessary assumption that output supply is constant. Small open economy is too small to influence the world real interest rate. And here the world real interest rate is 6%. So you can see on the vertical axis we have world real interest rate RW, which is equivalent to the world which is equal to the domestic interest rate, because it is already given. So all the lenders and all the borrowers in the domestic economy are following this real interest rate. And on the horizontal axis we have desired national savings and desired investment. Now you can see for a closed economy, the equilibrium interest rate is 4%, where the desired savings and investment are equal. But for the open economy, where for which it's not necessary, and in this case, the equilibrium interest rate might be different because we earlier mentioned that whatever the world real interest rate, it has to be followed by the lenders and borrowers in the home country for lending and borrowing from other countries at this interest rate. So you can see here the 6% interest rate at an interest rate of 6%, which is a world real interest rate, and at this interest rate the desired investment is 1 billion, whereas the desired savings are 5 billion. It means that 5 minus 1, which gives us the value of net lending, it means that this small open economy can lend out 4 billion in to other nation. And we can also say that this 4 billion is equal to net exports as well. this 4 billion is equal to net export, this 4 billion is equal to current account, because we said that the gap between export and import is equal to the current account. Now we can see that current account of this small open economy is in surplus with a value of 4 billion. Right? Now, does it satisfy the condition that we have been discussing from the very beginning of our chapter, that goods market of a small open economy is in equilibrium? When one condition is satisfied mathematically, what is that? That particular condition is desired savings have to be equal to the desired investment plus the net exports. Now, desired saving here is 5 and desired investment is 1. So 5 is equal to 1 plus 4 is the amount of 4 billion is the amount that is exported to other nations. So it satisfies the condition of the goods market equilibrium. Now we can say that even these savings are desired saving is larger than desired investment at a world real interest rate of 6%. The small open economy is in equilibrium. Now we can perform small calculations to show you with more clarity, because this is something that need to be shown somewhere. So let's what we are trying to show, whether the small open economy is in equilibrium. We are trying to look at the condition small open economy's equilibrium. Small open economy's small open economies equilibrium. All right, so we have already shown it graphically, but we are trying to perform some calculations here so that we can provide some numerical insights to the graphical idea that we have analyzed in a figure. So equilibrium condition of a small open economy looks like this, right? And you can calculate, this is the equilibrium condition. This is equilibrium condition. So you can find out the desired net lending for small open economy by subtracting the amount of desired investment from desired lending, just by rewriting the above equation in this way. So we can rewrite the equation to find out the net lending in this way. Now, so the gap between saving and investment will give us the amount of money funds that is lent out to other nations. So you can use this, you can use both. We call it A and we are calling it B, suppose. Now, first you need to find out the net lending. So we know from the graph that desired saving at a world, we can write this condition as when the world real interest rate is 6%, the home economy's interest rate is also the same. So at that interest rate, the desired savings in the home country is equal to 6 billion, whereas the desired investment into the home country is equal to 1 billion. Now you can use equation B to calculate the net amount of net lending that is to be made by the home country to foreign country. So it's 6 billion minus 1 billion, which is what, which is equal to 5 billion. So you can substitute this 5 into the above equilibrium condition, that is equation A. How would you do it? You would do it this way. 5 is the desired savings and desired investment is 1 plus it is 6 billion. So desired saving is 6 billion, which is equal to desired investment, 1 plus the net export. Net exports or net lending is equal to 5. So this satisfies the condition for goods market equilibrium, and it verifies the idea that we know just in theory, but now we can back the theory with some proof that what we are saying is true mathematically as well. So we are proving it that desired saving in this economy is equal to desired investment plus the net amount of money lent abroad. So this condition is satisfied in our case. Now we begin. So we can see it from the diagram. Another condition that we represented mathematically, where the world real interest rate we assumed was 1%, but here it is 2%. At a world real interest rate of 2%, the small open economy is also in equilibrium. But here, at a world real interest rate of 2%, the desired savings are lower and the desired investment is larger. So it means that home countries businesses require more money than they are available in their home country. So how they are going to fulfill this gap? They are going to borrow from international market. Or alternatively, we can say that if the savings in a small open economy are lower than investment, it means that desired absorption or the proportion of output consumed within the home country is larger than the aggregate supply. What is needed in that scenario? In that scenario, there would be more imports than exports, right? So these are the alternative ways of explaining the equilibrium of a small open economy. So here the outcome is summarized that if the world real interest rate is RW, may be such that desired savings are larger than investment, or savings might be equal to desired investment, or the third possibility is desired saving might be lower than the desired investment. So this is a summary of what we have discussed up till now, which means that if the desired saving are larger than desired investment, the excess of desired saving over investment is lent out internationally, which means that there would be a net foreign lending, and NX is larger than zero, which means it is positive. If desired saving is equal to investment, it means that there's no foreign lending and net exports are equal to zero, like we had in closed economies model. But the last scenario, where the desired saving is lesser than desired investment, the excess of desired investment over desired saving has to be financed by borrowing internationally. Now this table was important, which I explained earlier. Now I'll be discussing it in a very shorter way, because we have earlier explained it. So gross domestic product, which is output supply, is fixed at 20. Government purchases of 4 billion are also fixed. So by assumption from the beginning of the chapter, we are assuming that there is the supply of output is at its full employment level and it is fixed to a fixed value, which is 20. And government, because the process of the government or the political process of countries is different from one another, so we cannot make a generalized statement about it. That is why we are assuming it to remain fixed. Now, when the world real interest rate is, let's say we have talked about 6 and 4. We have talked about 6 and 2%. Let's talk about the 2. So when the world real interest rate is 4%, let's say. Now at this world real interest rate, desired consumption is 13, desired investment is 3. Now, if you need to find out the desired absorption, what you will do, you will add consumption plus investment plus government purchases. 13 plus 3, 16 plus 4, 20. So this is desired absorption. So desired absorption and output supply, 20 minus 20, which will give us the value of net lending. So in this case, where the desired absorption is 20, net lending are the desired foreign lending is equal to zero because supply as well as demand are equal. And how would you calculate desired national savings? By subtracting national income from, by subtracting consumption and government purchases from national income. So you have 20 as a national income. You would subtract consumption, which is 13, and government purchases of 3 to get a value of desired national saving. So desired national saving and investment both are equal, 3 billion, and this is also 3 billion. So both conditions are satisfying the idea that goods market is in equilibrium. So net exports are equal to net foreign lending, and net foreign lending is equal to current account balance. So we know this from our previous lecture. Now I'll be discussing the shocks to the small open economy. So I had a discussion with you in our previous class that open economy is affected by various economic shocks. Like we considered a situation of an adverse supply shock, where we said that a country is experiencing, let's say, a drought, or maybe an open economy may also be affected by an increase in the oil prices. So if the oil price in the international market goes up, it will raise the cost of production of various goods into the home country. So how would be the goods market affected by this change? So when the oil price increases, it would lead to increase in the cost of production. When the cost of production goes up, the home country's producers are going to produce less output. So it would also be interpreted as a adverse supply shock. But like what will be the impact on the goods market equilibrium? If the demand is same, there would be lower supply into the goods market equilibrium. So similar kinds of things are going to happen. So what we discussed in our previous class, that suppose if a temporary adverse supply shock hits a small open economy, so we called it a drought. A drought which is going to reduce the production of an economy. So when production decreases, income is going to decrease. And when income is going to decrease, a fraction of it goes to saving. So savings are going to fall. We can see that earlier the small open economy was able to lend out money equal to the difference between A and B. But after this drought, because of lower income, people are able to save less. So the national savings have declined from S1 to S2, which caused what? Which caused this small open economy to lend out a lesser proportion of money to other nations relative to what it was able to export or lend out to other nations earlier. So the impact of temporary supply, adverse supply shock is represented here. Now, I want you to think about a case which I provided earlier, which I said that suppose if in international market price of oil goes up, how would it affect the home country's goods market equilibrium? How it means that how it would affect the demand and supply in the home country. Let's understand it in a layman's language. So whenever the international prices in the international market goes up, and we are assuming our home country as a Pakistan. So the producer's cost will go up, because all the producer who are using oil as an input to produce output, because oil is a major input used in almost production of various goods. So when when the price of oil goes up, it will add up to the cost of the businesses. And the revenue is supposed fixed. Cost will go up, their profits will decline. It means their business's income is going to decline. And when the oil price goes up, the cost of transportation and various other costs are going to rise for the consumers. So it means that an increase in oil price will bring what? Will bring inflation into the home country if we are an importer of oil. And when inflation is there, because earlier we had no discussion on inflation because we have not yet arrived at it. But let's make some basic idea of it in this chapter. If the inflation is there, there would be lesser value of the income that people are having. So people, in response to inflation, will be able to buy less and save less. So ultimately, saving would fall the way that it has declined here from S1 to S2. And it will lead to a kind of lower current account surplus that we can see in front of us in this diagram as well. So now you have a general understanding as well relative to the specific case that we are looking here, right? Another case that we considered in our discussion was of positive supply shock. Now, Pakistan economy is currently experiencing a positive supply shock because we are importer of oil and international oil price has been reduced, and we are importing as much oil as we can, and the oil price in the country has declined, and producers can take benefit, but not in the short run, but will take the benefit in the long run because businesses are not operating at their full capacity because there's a lockdown from 9 to 5. The businesses are opened up, but they cannot open their businesses after 5. From 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. is the time limit that they are restricted to. So it means that all the businesses in the country are not operating at their full capacity. So even if the oil price has been reduced in the home country, the producers are not able to realize its benefit. Their cost bill can decline to significant level once the production assemblies are working at their full potential. So what can be the outcome of it? In the temporary time, they are going to have lower cost of production for the producers. So they can produce more output, but because there is lesser demand in the market, they are not supplying enough output. So this is a more complex case than we are looking in theory, because in theory we are assuming so many things to remain constant. So I'm coming back to the context of book, but you need to have basic understanding of the things that are happening around you, because you are enrolled in a course of macroeconomics, and if you don't know that there is no ceteris paribus in the real world, there's a chain of events that causes other events, and you need to understand how to break down that chain to arrive at some meaningful conclusions. Anyways, so in our previous class, we considered a case of a small open economy, but we now consider the case of, like, we are now looking at positive supply shock, and positive supply shock is one that raises production and income of economy. And here specifically we are saying that there's an increase in the expected future marginal product of capital. What does that mean? It means that currently businesses in the home country are experiencing a technological improvement which makes capital more productive and causing businesses to buy more capital. So they are investing, demanding more capital. So investment will go up, and when the investment will go up, so it means that desired absorption in the country is rising. So when desired absorption relative to the fixed output that we assume is rising, it would allow the country to send less amount of money abroad. So their net lending is going to fall, which we can see from this diagram. So now you can see here 5.5, an increase in expected future marginal product of capital, which means that a technological change is making multiplying the productivity of capital. So whenever the input becomes more productive, a particular input gets more productive, there's an incentive for businesses to invest or buy more of that input so that they can raise their sales and maximize the profit. So that's what being represented in a context of a national economy. You can see that we have the world real interest rate, which is fixed. Earlier we had an equilibrium. Earlier we had an equilibrium at this I1 and S1 curve. But after the positive supply shock, which caused investment to rise from I1 to I2, now the desired absorption in the country has increased. It means that the amount of money that we were able to lend out to foreigners has now decreased, because that amount is used by businesses in the home country to buy more capital. So you can see that earlier the gap AB was exported to other nations or lent out to other nations, but now F and B, the gap between F and B is the amount. So the current account surplus has declined in response to a larger demand by home countries' businesses for capital. So are you following me? Are we clear about this open economy? So when we are analyzing the goods market equilibrium of a large open economy, we need to understand that a large open economy is large enough to affect the world real interest rate. It means that large open economies lending and borrowing and international trade are of two larger volume relative to small open economy. So because of the larger volume, the world real interest rate can be influenced. So that is why we cannot assume the world real interest rate to remain fixed when we are talking about the goods market equilibrium of a large open economy. Second assumption that we'll be making in our analysis is that we are considering two large open economies. One is, we are supposing that there are only two countries in the world and both are large open economies. One is home country, another one is foreign country. So the world real interest rate will be determined by their lending and borrowing pattern or their import and exports. Now, what does that mean? It means that China is one large open economy and it is considered as a home country, and US is another foreign economy, which is also a large open economy. So the amount of money that China is willing to lend out to US, if that amount matches, which means that if the amount of money that China is willing to lend out to US or US is willing to borrow are equal, that particular interest rate will be considered as a world real interest rate. In other words, the amount of goods, the amount of, let's say, when US is running a current account deficit, it means that China will be running a current account surplus. So because we assume that there are only two countries in the world, so if US is running a current account deficit, it means that US is importing more goods from China than what China has imported from the US. So if US is running a current account surplus, China will definitely be experiencing a current account surplus. So if, let me rephrase it, I guess I made a mistake. So what I said is, if US is running a current account deficit, it means that China is running a current account surplus with the same value, because we are assuming two countries only, both are large open economies. And now if you just understand it more fully, like what does that scenario is trying to offer, what kind of basic insight it provides us when we are considering that China is running a current account surplus, it means that China has got more money which it can give to US so that US can pay for its imports. So So China is running a current account surplus, but China's finance capital and financial account will definitely be in negative deficit, right? But US current account like is in deficit already, but US is in need of money. So US will borrow from China to pay for their imports. So in this way, both countries are going to have a scenario where their balance of payment equation is satisfied. So do you got the rough idea of what I am trying? All right. So we just defined some assumptions of the large open economy. Now we are talking about goods market equilibrium. In large open economy. We said that first scenario that we establish is we assume that for the world when we have all right. So we were here. So we assume that we have two countries. Two countries in the world. We have home country, which is also, we have one country as home country and another one as foreign economy. All right. So after defining this, we are going to write another assumption, that is the world real interest rate will be determined by the interaction of these two economies, which means what? The world in real interest rate will be decided when the lending of the home country, so L stands for lending, international lending by the home country is equal to the international borrowing by the foreign country. So which means what? When the amount of money that home country is willing to lend out to foreign economy is equal to what foreign economy is willing to borrow. What does that mean? If home country is willing to borrow lend out 200 billion and foreign economy is willing to if home country is willing to lend out 200 billion and foreign economy is also willing to borrow 200 million, so that equality will give us the world real interest rate. So it means that the world real interest rate would be equal to a value of a particular constant when the international lending must have to be equal to international borrowing. So we can also rewrite this way. World real interest rate will be equal to when the borrowing from the home country is equal to lending by the foreign country. So we can use this knowledge for so now we are going to represent the idea graphically. So we have on the left side, we are placing home country. So we have world real interest rate, and this is desired investment. says desired savings. We need to mention excess. So we'll be writing desired savings and desired investment. And we are writing here the home country. Let's say so this is desired savings. And desired savings. Now we need to consider the world real interest rate. Suppose if the world real interest rate is this much, any value here. Suppose if the world real interest rate is 6%, at 6% interest rate, this much is the saving in the home country, the investment, and this much is a lending in the borrowing. It belongs. Red graph belongs to the foreign economy. I'm mentioning it in a light. I forgot to mention it. So let's first mention it. And both are large open economies, right? So at 6% interest rate, this is the amount of investment in the home country, and this is the amount of borrowing into the home country. So investment is 150 and borrowing is 450. Investment is, we can mention it, that investment into the home country I is equal to 150, and saving at this interest rate into the home country is equal to 450. So how much is available for lending abroad? So 450 minus 150, 300 billion are available at world real interest rate of 6%. To the home country for lending out abroad. Now let's analyze what is a scenario in the foreign economy. At a world real interest rate of 6%, foreign economy has got a saving of 100 billion and invest like a saving of 550 billion and investment of 650. So this SD is equal to 500, let's say, and investment is, let's say, 650. 650 is equal to what? Desired investment. Now you can calculate the gap. So foreign economy is in need of how much money? Foreign economy requires 150 billion. So it means that international lending of home country is not equal to international borrowing of the foreign economy. So this 6% interest rate is not the world equilibrium interest rate, because the above condition is not satisfied. What is the above condition? That lending and borrowing of international lending of one economy must have to be equal to the international borrowing of another economy. Now, if we consider an interest rate lower than 6% somewhere here, interest rate of, let's say, 5%. So what would be the scenario in both economies now? So at an interest rate of 5%, you would see that saving in the home country is 200. Sorry, investment into the home country is 200 and saving is 400. So investment is 400. So we can write it here. ID is equal to 400, whereas the saving into the home country is sorry, I is 200 rather 400. It's equal to desired investment at an interest rate of 5% in the home country is equal to 200 rather than 400. And desired savings into the home country are equal to 400 at a world real interest rate of 5%. So it means that net lending, the amount of money available to the home country for lending out abroad is 200 billion. Now let's look at it here. Does it match with the foreign country's lending borrowing? So we can show here that at a 5% world real interest rate, saving is 500. This is SD. Desired saving at a world real interest rate of 5% is 500, and desired investment at a world real interest rate of 5% is 700. So the gap between saving and investment is 200. So this 5% interest rate can be called as a world real interest rate because it satisfies this condition that the amount of money that home country is willing to lend out internationally to another foreign economy matches with the amount that foreign economy is willing to borrow. So we can say that international borrowing is equal to international lending at a world real interest rate of 5%. And the condition can be seen from by looking at both the diagrams. So how do we write in summary to the above case? We would say that at a world real interest rate of 5%, the lending of the home country is equal to the borrowing of the foreign country, which means that at a world real interest rate of 5%, 200 billion is a lending amount that home country is willing to lend out to foreign country. So foreign country is willing to borrow 200. So both international lending and borrowing are equal. Alternatively, if you just look at the diagram and analyze the idea in a more in a very different way, so you can also do it as well. So initially at the world real interest rate of 6%, the home country was running a current account surplus of 300 billion, and the foreign economy was running a current account surplus of how much billion? 150 billion. So foreign economy only required 150 billion to manage that surplus, but home economy had more money. So because of more money available into the international market, what was observed into the market forces, the amount at which lending and borrowing take place in international market declined from 6% to 5%. And now the home country is left with current account surplus of 200 billion, and it matches with the current account deficit of foreign economy of 200 billion. So it means that when the home country was running a current account surplus of 200 billion, so that money was lent out to foreign. It means that home country is now balancing its balance of payment equation, because when the home country is willing to lend out 200 billion, it means that capital and financial account decreases by 200 billion of the home country, and 200 billion increase will be observed in the foreign country's capital and financial account. In this way, both countries are managing their balance of payment. So the last topic of the chapter we'll be discussing is the fiscal policy and current account, the relationship between these two. We know that fiscal policy is a government policy relating to government spending and taxation. And we also know that it has an impact on current account of the country. So there's a debate among economists of various groups that does fiscal policy impact the current account, and if it does impact, then what are the ways it with which it affects the current account. So I was telling you about the relationship, last topic of this chapter, saving an investment in open economy, which was very important. Now the last topic we are left with is understanding the relationship or the linkage between fiscal policy and current account. So there's, I was telling you that the ongoing debate in the subject of macroeconomics about what are the ways fiscal policy and current account are linked with each other. So economists, some economists are of the opinion, they believe that whenever the government is running a budget deficit, it will also impact the current account deficit. So what does that mean? Some economists are of the opinion that budget deficits are going to cause the current account deficit. So they term this idea as twin deficit. What does that mean? It means that budget deficit, which is excess of spending over revenues, if let's say government is spending more than its revenue, it means that government is running a deficit. And you know that the definition of current account deficit, right? It means that current account deficit in our discussion means exports are smaller than imports, right? So whenever a country is running a budget deficit, it will lead to a current account deficit, which economists are calling as twin deficit. And we as a nation are also affected by these both. Like what economists are, some economists are believing is true for our case, that Pakistan economy is currently facing both. We are facing a budget deficit. Every time our budgets are, every time the money that government spend is larger than the revenue that the government earns. And we are also having a current account deficit because our imports are always larger than exports. From, if we just take the data of past 10, 15, 20 years, the imports have always been larger than the exports, right? And remittances have been too lower compared to the population of Pakistan living abroad, because they are not sending it using registered sources, because they don't have trust on the institutions of the state, and there are other reasons as well. So for now, let us put aside the practical discussion, just understand the theoretical idea so that we can apply it to explain various other things. So now you know the meaning of twin deficit. This is a phrase that economists use when they say that a country is experiencing whenever they say there's a twin deficit, it means that budget deficit and current account deficit both are there. So it means that let me give you an illustration. Suppose when I say budget deficit, what does that mean? It means that government is spending more than its taxes. So it means that government is running a budget deficit, and that budget deficit, whenever there's a budget deficit, when the government spending increases, the government is running a budget deficit, the national savings of economy would fall. And whenever national savings would fall, you know that amount that the country could lend out, or the amount of goods that the country was able to send out abroad, would also fall, which is equivalent to saying that net lending would fall, or is equivalent to saying that current account surplus would fall. So this is how a budget deficit is causing what? A current account deficit, that is being represented here. Are we clear? So we have a basic understanding of, now let's assign some numerical values to this abstract discussion. Suppose government is spending 1,000 billion, let's say, and government only collected 800 billion in taxes. So it means that government spending G is larger than T. Government is running a budget deficit of 200 billion, right? If the government is running a budget deficit of 200 billion, how does it will affect the current account? There's a budget deficit equivalent to what? Equivalent to 200 billion. Now, government is using, now how would the government manage this deficit? If the government is, let's say, suppose if the government is, government had, government is using already जो सेविंग्स पड़ी हुई है गवर्नमेंट उसको यूज कर रही है सपोज इफ द गवर्नमेंट इज यूजिंग द सेविंग्स दैट वर मेड अर्लियर सो अल्टीमेटली द नेशनल सेविंग्स वुड फॉल बाय द अमाउंट ऑफ बजट डेफिसिट एंड दिस नेशनल सेविंग वुड काज व्हाट इट वुड काज द नेट एक्सपोर्ट्स टू फॉल ऑफ द सेम अमाउंट 200 बिलियन एंड नेट लैंडिंग दैट वाज अवेलेबल for other countries, like the amount of money that the country could use to buy foreign assets has now decreased because government is spending more than its revenue. So net lending, it would fall. So it means that country is now able to accumulate lesser foreign assets. So this would ultimately lead to current account deficit of 200 billion. So in this way, the budget deficit is causing what? The budget deficit is causing current account deficit. So this scenario is, this is a theoretical idea. This is a theoretical idea just to make you understand how countries are going to, whenever the country, whether it's a small open economy or a large open economy, whenever the country is going to run a budget deficit, some economists view that it can also affect the current account deficit. But there is only one link you can note here. You need to bear this in mind that budget deficit will affect the current account deficit if and only if the budget deficit is affecting the national savings. So if you just remove the national savings from discussion, there would be no linkage between budget deficit and current account deficit. It means that in summary, we can say that if we have to summarize the whole idea into something meaningful that we are trying to extract out of it. So we are saying that whenever there is a budget deficit, so budget deficit would cause what? National savings to fall. And this national saving would lead the countries to face current account deficit. So this is how it is linked. You cannot exclude this channel when you are talking about some economists who are believing or who are having a view opinion that whenever the countries are experiencing a budget deficit, it would lead to a current account deficit just because budget deficit decreases the amount of savings already available to the nation. So this is the idea. Okay, so this is the idea that we need to understand first, and now we are going to represent it using a diagram. So now what we are trying to show is the above idea with the help of a diagram. So you can use, before I draw it here, you can see this idea from the diagram that is available in our slides. So you can see it here. Yes, this is what we are discussing. The idea of twin deficit has already been discussed. Now we are saying an increase in government budget deficit raises the current account deficit only if the increase in budget deficit reduces desired national savings. So the book has exemplified a case of a small open economy where the military is spending for a smaller period of time, causing government to run a budget deficit that reduces the desired national saving and causes the current account deficit. You can see it here. The government budget deficit and the current account in a small open economy. So like earlier, the equilibrium was with investment curve I1 and saving curve S1. Now, after the increase in government spending, keeping if the government is spending more and the revenue of the government, that is tax revenue, is fixed. Now, how does it affect the scenario that we are trying to look into the figure? Government budget deficit will increase. It will cause national savings to fall from S1 to S2. And when the national savings would fall from S1 to S2, earlier the amount of money that was available to be lent out abroad or the current account surplus earlier was equivalent to the difference between A and B, the difference between saving and investment, A, B. But now, after the decline in saving as a result of budget deficit, the country can only lend out the money equal to AC, which is smaller than the difference AB. So it means that budget deficit led to the current account deficit that some economists are trying to make you understand. So now we can show this in our All right. We can show this up using the same diagram for our clarity. So we have got world real interest rate on vertical axis and desired savings and desired investment. What we are trying to show, the relationship between current account and the budget deficit, the government policy and current account. So we have desired savings, desired investment, and the world real interest rate is somewhere here. The world real interest rate is, let's say, this much. So this is RW. Now, earlier, before the budget deficit, the scenario was this. A and B was the amount. AB, the distance between AB is equal to net export. This is equal to current account surplus. This is equal to net lending. So this was the difference earlier. But now, when the government is running a budget deficit, because the government is spending money on a military, updating military equipment, suppose for a small open economy, and the tax revenue is fixed, and government is buying the military equipment using the same amount of revenue. So it would lead to what? If the revenue is fixed and the spending is rising in this year, government will run a budget deficit. That budget deficit will cause what? That budget deficit will exhaust or consumes some amount of savings. So national saving would fall. It would lead to a decline in current account surplus, which can be represented here. There would be, when the government runs a budget deficit, the national saving curve would shift from SD1 to, let's say, SD2. So this is a shift in the saving curve. Now the new equilibrium would be here because the world real interest rate is fixed. So we call it AC. Now AC we can say that at AC, the net exports are relatively lower than AB. Which we can write it as AC is less than AB. We can say that current account surplus or the current account surplus that was or the amount of money that was available for lending out abroad is now lower than what it was before. So it means that this is true. Government budget deficit can cause current account deficit if and only if national savings are affected.